As a composer who came of age in the 1960s, Beckwith was a man of his time. He could compose music that was difficult, ascetic, and that employed serial techniques. Did this make him a modernist? Beverly Diamond.
Well, I don't know whether we defined modernism quite so clearly until the last two decades. I think that it's only been sort of as we saw that period come to an end that there was an effort to define really what had been going on. And perhaps, as we often do, we define things a little bit too narrowly. It became associated, modernism became associated often with the tradition of serialism that came out of Austria and developed in many directions, but we may forget that there were many other modernisms.
The other day, Pierre Boulez visited Canada, and the headline was "The Last of the Moderns." Well, bullshit. There are lots of us around who still consider ourselves modern. We, I say, people of my generation in composition, I think we're asking ourselves the question, where is music going? What will be the next direction that music is going to go in? Okay. It went towards Romanticism, it went towards Impressionism, it went towards Expressionism. What's the next kind of thing it's going to do? It went towards machine music. What's it going to go now? And I think we were interested in those questions to the point where we went off in several directions, total serialism, aleatorism, whatever. And it was all very exciting, but then come to the point where you liked one part of it better than another. And those became your individual habits.
The composers who were at the center of the composition world in the 1960s regarded themselves as the carriers of modernism in Canada, and that was, at that time at least, that was certainly seen to be the direction that composition was going to go. Now, that's changed substantially. I think the only thing that might have been a little different about Beckwith relative to his peers is that he was really, really interested in a distinctive Canadian style and Canadian sound. And it's for that reason that he was interested in vernacular traditions, and he was interested in using elements of music making in his compositions that reflected the world around him.
Beckwith could compose music that was pure and abstract. Webern had provided the formal model, one that often led the composer to arrange the music as a kind of patchwork quilt. But if Beckwith wanted to bring to his music a sense of time and place, to make a distinctly Canadian music, he had to look elsewhere for a model. He found it in the music of the American composer Charles Ives.
And that was a big breakthrough for me. That was something that I found had a North American attractiveness to it, and brought out all my latent memories of pop music and church music and what else, and put it all together in a grand jumble. And you could do that in music, I've proved. I didn't think you could, but there he proved you could.
¶¶ Beckwith's search for a distinctly Canadian musical voice has led him to the richness of Canada's past. His music resonates with a fondness for the hymns of the 19th century religious sect, the Children of Peace. He also responds to the powerful sense of time and place evoked by some of Canada's finest writers. He's collaborated with James Rainey, Margaret Atwood, and B.P. Nicholl, and set the words of Margaret Lawrence and Dennis Lee. He's mindful that the influences and borrowings in much of his music can be viewed as derivative. But fellow composer István Anhalt observes that Beckwith is a composer of magic eclecticism, in whose works influences and borrowings give up a part of their identity and take on new roles. John Beckwith.